destroyed my life. I just want to say one thing to my wife and home. Yo, Adrian! I did it!
Very, very young. It's a different world. Yo. times a little bit.
But you almost don't have to, because even when I introduced you, somebody shouted, obviously.
You're Adrian.
So how much has the industry changed just because you were kind of talking about that for you?
Okay, well, a lot of stuff it's like we see in our lives, so-called handmade films are a thing of the past, where you went out there with a camera and an inspiration and a good idea, and if it was physical, you did your stunt, to be myself or Arnold Van Damme or Bruce, whatever. You go out there, you get beat up a little bit, but you say, okay, I made that film. That's a handmade movie. And then science comes along, and as you know, once science gets involved, it now becomes a matter of technology. So you don't have to do that anymore. And I think it's brilliant. I mean, it's very, very entertaining. You have companies like Marvel that are literally making, it costs $500 million to make a movie. Rocky costs $860,000, especially when you're not expecting it. So I had a period where, for 9 years, spiderweb covered my phone. I mean, it was bad. And you know, you take it out on people, you take it out on yourself. And you wonder, Jesus, if I ever get back, and no, I mean, I was unhireable. I was like the ninth lead in Spy Kids. It was like, are you kidding me? We're here. What? Yeah. I'm standing there behind a pencil, basically. What am I doing? And so I got a chance. I said, I'm gonna write one more Rocky. And I know nobody wants to make it. True story. Nobody wanted to make it. When I say you're dead, no, I'm serious, this is called dead. When you're dead in the industry, you're dead. And you have a momentum. And I see actors, I can see them coming and going, and you know they're gonna hit their plateau, and you wonder, can they get through it? Anyway, it was dead. No one called. My wife will tell you, I left California, I left the state, it was over. But I knew, I said, I got one more story to tell about a boxer, Rocky. Now, remember, the last Rocky was Rocky V. It bombed. People hated it. It was the death. They said, Stallone is over. So I said, no, it's a fact. Actually, I welcome this. It's good. No, it's a good thing.
It's like a good therapy session.
No, it's a good thing. So I spent years and years and years and years writing Rocky Balboa, the comeback. But understand, I'm 60 years old. 60 years old to play a fighter. No, they'll go, yeah, because let me tell you what they said. No. You're over. Rocky's over. The franchise is over. You're dead. Well, so let me, okay. And I'm telling you, it's over. We're at a bar, New Year's Eve. It's about 11:30 before New Year's Eve. Across the room, I see the producer who told me, never. You're done. Rocky's done. Because it's been, no. It's been 17 years since Rocky V, and it was a bomb. So he goes, why would we make another one 17 years later, you're 60 years old, that was a bomb? I go, but I'm telling you, this is about grief. Grief, who gives a shit about grief? I said, it's about dealing with life. So, if it hadn't been in that bar room, and the chances of that person being in Mexico in this bar room were a million to one, and we literally crossed paths. We didn't even like each other. He goes, I'll think about it. Well, he thought about it. He read the script. His wife shed a tear. He said, all right, we'll try it. And I'm back. People that are too sensitive lose. You lose.
It gets as bad as it can get. But most of the time, you don't win it.
I don't care. I ain't training if you don't get the treatment. So if I fight, you fight.
Thank you.
greatest night in the history of my life. I just want to say one thing to my wife and home. Yo, Adrian! I did it!
Drastically, it's like when you were all very, very young. It's a different world. keep up with the times a little bit.
But you almost don't have to, because even when I introduced you, somebody shouted, obviously.
Yo, Adrian.
So how much has the industry changed just because you were kind of talking about that for you?
Okay, well, a lot of stuff, it's like we see in our lives, so-called handmade films are a thing of the past, where you went out there with a camera and an inspiration and a good idea, and if it was physical, you did your stunts, if you're myself or Arnold Van Damme or Bruce, whatever, you go out there, you get beat up a little bit, but you say, okay, I made that film. That's a handmade movie. And then science comes along, and as you know, once science gets involved, it now becomes a matter of technology. So you don't have to do that anymore. And I think it's brilliant. I mean, it's very, very entertaining. You have companies like Marvel that are literally making, it costs $500 million to make a movie. Rocky cost $860,000, especially when you're not expecting it. So I had a period where, for 9 years, Spiderweb covered my phone. I mean, it was bad. And you know, you take it out on people, you take it out on yourself. And you wonder, Jesus, if I ever get back, and I was unhirable. I was like the ninth lead in Spy Kids. It was like, are you kidding me? We're here. Well, yeah, I'm standing there behind a pencil, basically. I'm doing. And so I got a chance. I said, I'm gonna write one more Rocky. And I know nobody wants to make it. True story. Nobody wanted to make it. When I say you're dead, no, I'm serious, this is called dead. When you're dead in the industry, you're dead. And you have a momentum. And I see actors, I can see them coming and going, and you know they're gonna hit their plateau, and you wonder, can they get through it? Anyway, it was dead. No one called. My wife will tell you, I left California, I left the state, it was over. But I knew, I said, I got one more story to tell about a boxer, Rocky. Now, remember, the last Rocky was Rocky V. It bombed. People hated it. It was the death. They said, Stallone is over. So I said, no, it's a fact. Actually, I welcome this. It's good. No, it's a good thing.
It's like a good therapy session.
No, it's a good thing. So I spent years and years and years and years writing Rocky Balboa, the comeback. But understand, I'm 60 years old. 60 years old to play a fighter. No, don't go, yeah, because let me tell you what they said. No. You're over, Rocky's over, the franchise is over, you're dead. Well, so, and I'm telling you, it's over. We're at a bar, New Year's Eve. It's about 11:30 before New Year's Eve. Across the room, I see the producer who told me, never. You're done, Rocky's done. Because it's been, no. It's been 17 years since Rocky V, and it was a bomb. So he goes, why would we make another one 17 years later, you're 60 years old, that was a bomb? I go, but I'm telling you, this is about grief. Grief, who gives a shit about grief? I said, it's about dealing with life. So, if it hadn't been in that bar room, and the chances of that person being in Mexico in this bar room were a million to one, and we literally crossed paths. We didn't even like each other. He goes, I'll think about it. Well, he thought about it, he read the script, his wife shed a tear, said, all right, we'll try it. And I'm back. People that are too sensitive lose. You lose.
It gets as bad as it can get. But most of the time, you don't win it.
I don't care. I ain't trying to feel good to treat. So if I fight, you fight.
My friend, it's all over me! I'm crying! All right, I'm here in England about to do memorabilia, but boy, did I come across something that's kind of shocking. I don't remember this movie at all, where Arnold is creeping up on me like that would ever happen.
So you remember Glenn from last year?
Yeah.
So he's the young artist. He's just, you know, his story is incredible. You know, he went to prison by obviously in a bad time, and he learnt to paint in prison. And now he's changed his life around. So he's doing paintings all over the world now. It's amazing.
Where did you get to paint?
All right, that was my full-time job in there in the art class. I was there every day in the art class.
Oh, really?
Painting away,
that's nice.
So this is your present from Glenn. That's a print.
Oh, good.
So that's your present.
It's on aluminium, look. That's aluminium.
Printed on aluminium.
So we can get that shipped as well.
Will
with
you ship that
steam? Yeah, of course.
What does Arnold sign?
Arnold signs very similar stuff, you know, paintings, knives from Predator.
Predator?
Yeah, Predator, and we got Terminator stuff on that, because it's the anniversary, so.
Tell him to sign Schnitzel. Tell him I said so.
Yeah.
Just kidding. He knows, we goof around. Michael B. Jordan, right? We're finishing up the movie, I wait. We do the same, about five things of charity. So I sign it, thank you, Michael. And like, it's like Shakespeare. And I go, just sign it, keep punching, Rob, Michael B. Jordan. I said, what's that? He goes, like Michael B. Jordan. I asked you to just like try.
Got this race, this is the first one I did this one out of the collection.
And you saw De Niro's signature.
Yeah.
Another beauty.
Do you know we had Robert De Niro last year as well?
No.
Yeah.
How'd you get him to open his mouth?
Well, exactly.
Robert, if you're watching this, I'm going to fight you sitting down on a rocking chair blindfolded using only these three fingers. Does that sound overly confident?
Just a little bit.
Just kidding, Robert. One finger.
Could do a drawing over.
So it's done.
Give us a bit of your art.
All I do is go around that side and just step. I wouldn't wait there. The hardest movies by far are boxing films because most guys can't fight.
No.
Unless you're working with a real boxer. And they can't act.
Yeah.
So to get the combination like a Mr. T or Dolph Lundgren, it's a miracle. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Even though Mr. T was not a classical fighter, all he could do is this.
It
was powerful.
Yeah.
So I said, okay, clubber. And it worked, see what I mean?
Yeah.
But Carl Weathers, man.
Yeah.
I've sparred with a lot of pros.
Yeah.
For a man who's not a fighter, couldn't touch him. I mean,
right, sir.
So it's unbelievable. It's so typical of our relationship.
Isn't it?
To be like this.
It's what they should have been.
To be like this and this.
You should have had a movie like that. You should have gone against each other one time.
I know. It was his fault. It's his fault. I wanted to work with him, but I wasn't worthy yet. Hi, I'm Sylvester Stallone, just like I was yesterday. And I just want to say it's great to be here in London. We're doing an amazing event, and hopefully you'll be there and keep punching.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Right, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to our first event with Sylvester Stallone. Obviously, this is the London event. We've got Manchester and Birmingham coming up next week. So, everything's going fantastic at the minute. Sylvester landed yesterday morning, a bit jet-lagged. And we did the signing yesterday, which went really, really well. You know, it was very accommodating. Can't wait to see his fans. So yeah, all that side's done. He's now resting at the hotel, ready to get here to do the event. So obviously in the background, as you can see, the room is getting ready now. We've got all the catering team setting the tables. We've got the production team, Spark, who are doing all the sound vision and lights. We've got the pyrotechnic guys setting up down here. We've got the stages gone in. So yeah, as you can see, it's a full logistical process to put these events on. You know, it's not just a case of putting a celebrity on stage and that's it. You know, it's literally a military operation, seriously. I mean, we're talking 3 months planning right up until this point. And the team will work through right and through till 1-2 o'clock in the morning to pack up and, you know, produce an event of the highest quality, which I'm sure you're all going to enjoy.
Okay.
So yeah, all good. Oh God, there's somebody I've just found off the street here. Who's this?
Hi, how are you?
Oh, this is my dad off the street. He was just homeless last night.
Yeah, I was homeless last night.
But I'll see you later. Him in our church.
Yes. I'm just talking to this lovely lady in regards to all this, just figuring out where to put the programmes. She didn't know that we were going to put programmes on here. So maybe our other team's going to do that, sort that out. I'm event support, whatever that is. See this? I've gone through hell and back to get this. In and amongst all this lot, all this production, all these lights and everything else. This is so important because it is for the stage, for Mr. Stallone, and if I didn't get this, there'd be trouble. How's about that?
Yeah.
It does actually look really good. It's so hard now.
Trying hard
now.
Go on, Jenny, that's right. Sorry.
Gonna
fly now. You're gonna
sing on the key.
Trying hard now.
Right, fantastic, lovely.
When I say that, usual things, you know, like my little light bulb, you know, little things like this.
Number four. Okay.
Could do with stapling him up. Perfect. Gagging for him,
can't be moving the chairs.
Stapling for Stephen.
So no matter how long you're in this game, you know, I've been in it since I was in 17, 18, doing little events with tribute Beatle bands, you know, tribute Stone Roses bands, getting into smaller dinner events and stuff, and obviously we are where we are today. But no matter what happens, my stress levels go through the roof every single time. Even though I've got such a vast team, honest to God, I'm a nervous wreck. So we've had a major issue today, the LED backdrop, which we had planned for today for one of the first time ever we're going to have done it. So it's a video wall along the back which moves and interacts with the stage. It's not turned up, it's late, so the supposed to be here at 2 o'clock, it's obviously 4 o'clock, we've had a cut-off time and had to get rid of him. So as you can see, we're using the original one we used for Robert De Niro, but my attention to detail, no CD is going nuts because I just wanted that video wall. But it's just one of them things, you know, we're going to use it again for Manchester and Birmingham. And the room's nearly finished. 4:25, got to go all the way into the centre of London now to a private dinner, which I'm stressing about because I'm not even ready. But the room's good, we're nearly there and it's going to be a great night.
I think it's all right when the lights are on.
No, I think it looks good there because it hides that crease as well. We've got piano man.
No, I think it makes it.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Fine.
Okay, we're going to jump to the last 20 seconds of this.
Again, you see,
now.
Little
now?
Things. Can't find a PowerPoint, but who cares? It looks good. Sort of goes with a piano, doesn't it? Happy days.
Did you need to get a passe?
What better way to spend a Friday or... Is it Friday or Saturday? I don't know, is it Saturday?
gosh, I tell you what, my head is mush because this is such a big event. And I didn't realise until I took a sneaky peek into this room. This is the Aurora Ballroom in the Intercontinental in London at the O2. And here we have it. Tables for 1,300 people. The only thing I would say is I'd have had paper plates because you could just chuck everything in a bin bag and get rid of it, saves on the washing up. But nonetheless, so there's going to be 1,300 people in here, all dressed up to the nines. It's a black tie do, totally glam. And they're not here to see me. Oh, no. They're here to see an experience with Sylvester Stallone. So I think he's probably here somewhere at the moment. And what's going to happen is this room will fill with all those glamorous people, and then we'll build up here on a big screen with all the famous movie montages from the Rockies and the Rambos, you name it. And the musical accompaniment will be from up here, and we'll have a guy from Holland called Nude van Huskamp who will play the classic da 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 da. And then, ladies and gents, it'll be time for me to introduce the one, the only, Sylvester Stallone. Gosh, you're looking good. Look how young you are. Gosh, what a complexion.
Thank you.
Amazing, yeah. So sly. Well, you're a bit early, aren't you?
Yeah.
It's all right, it's just warming up. It'll be fine later on, it'll be fine. Thanks, see you later, Sly.
Right, listen to me, right? No matter how many times I do this, the stress now. Yeah, we're just trying to figure out his entrance onto the stage. Because last year we had a rush to the stage, so we're just trying to figure this out. Yeah, this is raw behind the scenes stuff.
Hi, sorry. How long before you get him in, please?
Not long.
No, but give me some time, please.
I'd say 10 past 9.
10 past 9?
Yeah.
Here we go. It's like, I imagine this to be like, you know, in the tunnels for the football. I think it's a bit like that, only, you know, I haven't got a football kit on. Although some may wish that. And I don't think these are classed as football boots, are they? These are what you call killer heels. Yeah, and they are killing me. Dressed by Zeynep Kartel just then. Oh, hello everyone. All good? Catering staff, very important. Look, he's clearing the way for me, because obviously I'm diseased. And this is it. And I'm feeling, look, steady as. So, no, it's okay, it's fine. So, Mike is on here, just under my hair. Just have a quick fiddle. Okay, I've got my watch and my glasses because I can't see a thing. Some cue cards here.
Go ahead for more.
And obviously a selfie opportunity, but I don't think that's going to happen. But it's on airplane mode. Met Sylvester and lovely Jennifer and his daughter. And this is where the party starts. Everything's very finely tuned. Auctions, meal. Now it's time for showtime. What's going to happen? And the weird thing is, normally people think you're prepared, and I tend not to. And I was going, no, it's fine. I just feel my way, feel the mood of the audience and the guest. And then at this particular point, when you've got about 45 seconds left, you think, oh, should I be prepared? Fine, look. Steady.
Off the work.
Jimmy, how?
Oh,
now you ask yourself, do you get butterflies? Yeah, I guess so. You can call them butterflies. You can call them large moths. You can call it nerves. Or you can call it good fear. And you know what? I'm going to overcome this. I'm going to do it. Even if I fail, I'm going to try.
Like a yo back?
Yeah, I would, actually.
I think that'd be nice.
On the count of three. One, two, three. Yo! Okay, makes me feel at home. Thank
yeah.
you.
Okay, so.
My goodness. Are you out there? There you are. Okay, enough of the smoke. I'm going to see these beautiful people. No, it's just that I get accused of this all the time
oh,
at home.
Don't.
So I'm going to
oh,
really
God,
get
flexing.
It tonight. Oh, my God.
But the thing is, with Rambo, yeah. you know, I find like if I'm doing a TV show, I'm like, oh, I'm not going to the gym. I'm filming today. I can't do anything. You know, I can just about wash my hair. I think that's a chore. But for you, you were training before, after. You know, it was relentless for Rambo, wasn't it? What was your regime?
Well, the if you're directing it, it's and Rocky's, it's really a laborious, crazy, almost thankless thing, because you have to get up at a certain, you have to stay in shape yeah. for 6 months straight at least to do all the boxing, because there's 5 months of boxing, then you're acting, then you're directing, then you're writing, then you're dealing with the other actors, then yeah. at night you're going home and watching 3 or 4 hours of dailies, then you get up and start at 4 in the morning. It really is not, I don't recommend it. Mm. It's a real challenge that I thought I had to do it because I've seen what happens when you let go of a project and it's just not your vision. You go, God damn, why didn't I just do it myself? So I thought for the Rockies, the last few, I just had to get it done like that. Mm-hmm. But that becomes literally a lifestyle that I don't, you know, it's not a healthy one to get like that. I mean, it looks okay, mm-hmm. but I felt it's caused incredible damage. I've had 4 back operations, 2 neck fusions, knee replacement, elbow. I mean, you name it. So sometimes, it comes with a price.
Yeah, it does, and it's one of those, don't do that at home, people.
Yeah, really.
Yeah, really.
I think it's incumbent upon people while they have their time on this planet to try to venture out into areas where, you know, you don't feel so confident. And because I didn't. I mean, I never directed. I never wrote. I don't think I ever passed an English course. Until finally I was almost destitute on the street. I was 21 years old. And I said, now it's time to sink or swim. So I said, you know, no one's hiring you as an actor. Why don't you learn to write? But I didn't know how to write either. So I would go to the museum every day in the library, and just start to practice reading and looking at the great literature. And I thought maybe something would sink in. Well, it did not.
Oh.
It went for years. The worst kind of screenplays, like pretentious promises written on water, cry and whisper in the same breath. The bogus guy.
Oh, you know, I mean, I quite like
oh
that.
My God. I mean, it's like the revenge of Dr. Chocolate. It was like, you name it, the worst kind of things ever. Yeah. And then finally, you come across an idea and you go, that works, because it's not about you. Mm-hmm. It's about a situation. And that's when I realized that writing is about encompassing as many thoughts as you can or the feelings of the general population.
Yep. So you know, you sort of did live the part all the way through, which must be quite wearing, quite tiring. And
you know, some things you just feel comfortable with. Seriously, like it's like my wife will tell you, Rambo is definitely in the house before coffee.
Okay.
Before I have coffee, put that bow and arrow where I can't find it. You know, and then afterwards, sort of Rocky appears a little bit. Yeah, believe me. But now my daughters are so tough, they just threaten me. I just like, please, don't hurt me, don't hurt me.
I do love the way that, because you love your Instagram, but I was thinking, is it the girls that have influenced you? Because you do like a bit of Instagram, don't you?
I do.
I do.
I'm like, I don't know.
Do you get influenced by your girls?
Well, they talked me into it, and now I've become addicted to it. And
you are, aren't you?
Yeah. I mean, they think, like, what's wrong with you? You're never off. It's like when you corrected a child, so you have this adult. Why don't you put it down when you're eating, please? That kind of a thing.
I think I saw one, and it was with Jennifer. I hope she doesn't mind. But you were at home, and she does just what I do when someone picks up and they start doing a live story or something. I'm like, will you not do it? I'm not ready. I'm in my pajamas.
All the time.
Will you leave it?
That is true.
Yeah.
Everyone. Oh, no. I need full makeup. I said, no, you don't. You look great, guys. Yeah. But no, some people are very sensitive about that.
Cannes looked absolutely fantastic, the film festival this year.
Oh, yeah.
And you looked really emotional at some point.
I didn't want that to happen. I don't know why that happens. I think of myself, yeah, I'm bulletproof, man. This doesn't... And then you go, wow.
Wow.
Why am I here? Like, I was nobody. And when I say nobody, I mean nobody. And I'm looking around in this place, packed to the rafters, and they're celebrating, you know, Rambo character. And I'm like, damn, don't cry. Don't do it! I was like, fight it! But something comes out, I think, I don't know what it is. Maybe, I don't know how most people were raised, but a lot of times you're not raised with a lot of confidence. Uh-huh. And you either have to fight for it or manufacture it or fake it until you believe it, which I'm a big believer in, you know. Just keep faking it until it's real. Mm. You know, sometimes it may just click in. And I was raised in that kind of environment. It was rough. So the fact that I ended up there when I thought I was going to end up, you know, in some place, wow, very dark. It was a revelation. And my, you know, of course, the family's there to see it. I'm going,
it just
right,
looked such
take
a
me lovely now, Lord. I peaked.
Well, Mr. Stallone, you were meant to be there.
Hey!
Yes, you were.
People ask me, how did you do it? I said, because there was an opportunity back then that didn't exist today. Back then, they would make movies on a hunch. Mm. Today, they make movies by actually selling territories. Is very, very precise. They know how much that actor is worth in Germany, what you'll get in Belgium. I mean, seriously. So you won't get to see those kinds of movies that we sort of grew up in the 70s, this and that, Dirty Harry. They wouldn't make it today. It's just out of the question.
And not actors like you either, I have to say. And that's what really counts for you being here tonight, because, you know, I look at my kids' stuff, you'll never see an actor like that again. Not you won't. It's a different world.
It is a different world. Yeah. It's really something. And also what has happened is, if you were casting The Godfather today, that's why I think things happen at a certain time. Back then you had De Niro, Pacino, you had Jimmy. You couldn't cast it.
No.
There's no one to play the part. If you were doing Dirty Harry, good luck. Who's playing it? But that guy at that time presented an opportunity that's why I think when you do remakes sometimes, you're asking for big trouble. Because it's a certain element and a certain kind of mentality and a certain actor. Like Charles Bronson, forget it, done. So when they asked me to do Death Wish, I said, no. Because I made that mistake once with Get Carter.
Yeah.
And you know, you had the great Michael Caine do it. And so I want you to do a remake. I said, okay. And I learned the hard way that nostalgia and the identification at a certain period is very close to people's hearts, and they're not giving that up. And so, yeah. Thank you.
I have got a bit of a surprise for you. Nobody in production knows or anything, but have you heard of Wakefield? It's up north, don't worry. But I've got this lady, she's called Alana. And she's made me this, which I hope you like, and it's not rude, but it says sliced sack.
What? Sliced sack. Yeah.
So, what? It's a bit like a lucky dip.
Yep.
So what I want you to do is you put your hand in. I've done all this. It's amazing what you can get on Amazon. So I want you to put your hand in,
right,
draw something out, and then it'll be relevant to something about one of your movies in the past 45 years.
Well, that's a different...
I know, it's really, there's squinchy,
some is slick
there's,
and some is
there's
furry.
Weedy, there's whirly.
All right.
Go on, what have you got? Oh, that's not bad. So that's the goalie glove. Escape to victory.
Oh, this is the right crowd for that.
Perfect.
Wow.
So you're talking about Michael Caine before.
Yeah.
And Pelé.
Oh, you want to hear Michael?
I'd love one.
Here's a great story. Here, okay. You can hold my glove. Okay. So I'm there going, all right, how hard can this soccer be? Hey, big deal, little ball. So they bring out this World War II ball. I guess some people know that it looks like a cannonball. It's very, very, it's dark, it's menacing, it's heavy, especially when it hits the water. And the shoes they wore back then had steel tips. Today they would kill you, literally break your leg. I mean, that's how heavy they were. So Pele's there, I go, yeah, I've heard of you. And he goes, I'm gonna play the goalie. He goes, really? Have you ever done it? I go, no. I go, okay. You stand here in the goal. I'm gonna put the ball right there. I'm gonna stand there and there's nothing you can do about it. I go, yeah, right. So he kicks the first one and I go, okay. And I heard this. I'm telling you, what the fuck is that? And it's a old net, so it's aged, supposed to be look like World War II. Okay, here we go. Do that again. And now he goes, I want to put it right there. Okay, sure you are. He goes, this time I managed to get my hand out. It snapped.
You broke your finger. He broke his finger.
Ba-boom. Went past my hand, broke the finger, tore a hole through the net, and shattered the barracks windows that were covered in wire mesh. And I went, I'll never say that again. Thank you all, and keep punching!
This kid, let this kid hear me. Just give him space. Give this.
So nice to meet you.
Why are you dressed so nicely?
That's yours, Chris.
Yeah. Is that a shot? All right, take it.
Yeah, if you take a photo.
Here we
go. You
go.
You know what? I don't know. What did you do?
Oh. You pressed that for a picture.
There you Were go. You there today?
Yes.
Oh my goodness.
He came up to me and I was like, I'll see what I can do.
Oh, that's great, though.
Thank you. Could you sign my pictures?
Yeah.
Thank you.
You've got some.
Here you are.
Okay, you pull the top. Okay. You want this one?
Yes, please.
Sylvester.
Now I have a phone. You can see it.
And keep punching.
And can you sign that one?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. Let's get this one up here so we can see it. There we go.
Thank you so much. Well, I'll bring him over to his
parents. Is this yours?
Yes.
What's your name?
No, I would love it to be from you. I don't want it to me, to my mom, to my dad. I want it off you.
Dan, you missed that. I cannot believe that.
Okay, you know what? You got to say that.
No.
Again.
I don't want it off
you. Do you want me to sign this for you?
Yeah. No. I want you to not do it for my mom, my dad, or me. I want your name on it. No one
really?
Else's.
I love this young man. Here we go. Okay. I'm going to give you the full thing. This is, believe it or not, I'd like to walk around with this name, Sylvester. You better learn how to box. But how about this one? You know his name.
Oh, wow.
What's your name, Carlo Lee?
E-A-L-B-O-A. There it is. And keep
punching.
And that's the truth, man. As long as you got a fist and you keep pushing it forward, you're going to knock something down. There you go.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. Guys.
Thank you. Can I get
yeah, thank you.
Nice meeting you.
Look at this guy. So, you know what?
get your
what
phone
is your IQ? About 3,000?
Can you get your phone now and take a photo?
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. He approached me when I was working. I was like, I don't know if I can do it. But
definitely going to take a photo.
Yeah, please do.
Look at him. He's going to be mayor. Exactly. I want to introduce you to your next prime minister. Thank you very much. You remember me when you're up there, okay? So, where's your photo? There we go. Is this your son?
No, he approached me. I'm working here.
Really?
I'm working here.
Well, he's your son now.
Yeah.
Thank you guys.
Take care.
Thank you.
So, the female to go to the green room. Excellent job.
I've got my bouncers and I've got my slippers. I did actually take my shoes off very early on. And I'm going to put my slippers on my gym jams and I'm going to have a nana nap. And then I might just come out pretending I'm like young and funky and drink in the bar and dance on the bar. None of that happened, by the way. None of it. I'm so boring.
A nana nap, that's something worth
it. A nana nap, yeah. At a certain age, me and Sly were talking about it. You have to have a nana nap. You just have it, I'd have it at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Just have a quick sneaky little sleep. I don't sleep in my bed though. I've got another bedroom I go to, and that's my nana nap bedroom, because otherwise you associate it with your normal nap. Do you want to talk about this now?
Yeah. Yeah, it's been a good night. Absolutely fantastic. Mr. Stallone was chilled out, relaxed. He actually wanted to stop. Been one of them nights, little problems. Couldn't get the venue to clear the smoke, which was a bit irritating, but apart from that, yeah, it was absolutely spot on. See all these lovely people going for the photographs now. I didn't think there were that many actually, but lots of positive comments. Loved it. All the best. Thank you.
Okay. Like, do you want a stool?
Yeah, so I have a nana nap in a separate room as opposed to my proper sleep. About 2 till 3 in the afternoon. In the winter, it gets dark.
You're like a turkey.
I'm like Cuff and Link. They're probably the same. I think they're 55 and nearly the same age as me. In fact, I'm almost as old as his turtles. In fact, I probably look like his turtle underneath all this schlep. Yeah. But anyway, the Christmas cracker is coming off. And I'm going to go and read my reviews for tonight. You know what I'm saying?